My name is Ann Ray. I'm the moderator for this event. So welcome. We are here for UpskillOK Career Focused Credentials Roundtable. And I feel like our presenters need no introduction.
Notorious.
is the Director of Online Learning Excellence. I'm Tracy Romano, Manager of Academic Online and Workforce Development Initiatives, both with the Regents. And the more that I work with the representatives of the Regents, the more I notice how great they are as a group. So I know this is going to be a wonderful presentation and
thank you, Anne, and thank you all so much for being here to talk about micro-credentials today. Like Anne said, I was one of those people before I started working at the Regents that thought everybody was very stiff and wore suits all the time, and sometimes we do wear suits all the time, but we're not very stiff, and we are all really friendly and care about the jobs that you do every day, especially serving the students, but also the faculty and staff across your campus, including each other. So I'm going to warn you all up front. Every time that we have done this kind of a roundtable discussion or presentation about UpskillOK, we get reactions that it's like drinking from a fire hose, because there's a lot of information that we're going to try to cram into here today, a lot of ideas that may be new to you, some tools that may be new to you, or hopefully you've heard this before, because we've been doing micro-credentials and badging for a while, and maybe this is just a refresher or an opportunity for you to share ideas with your colleagues. But again, Tracy and I really work together to try to keep afloat with the micro-credential process. So if any of you all have ever submitted a micro-credential program to the state regions for review, one of us has looked at it. We're kind of the first step of the evaluation process and then get them loaded on the website. So that's really the outcome for today that I hope for you all, is that you understand what a micro-credential is, what a digital badge is, and can distinguish those two things, because they are, and ultimately also understand how you can take advantage of this opportunity within your institution through this program approval process we've set up, which is highly abbreviated compared to the way that we normally do things. Thank you, Scarlett. Before we start out, I would also like to ask just for a raise of hands. Would you mind raising your hands if you have a direct responsibility of micro-credential programs on your campus? So a number of hands in here, which I think is great, especially knowing that you all come from different units across your various campuses, the hands that I saw raised here. So Tracy and I have been on the road doing this presentation about micro-credentials, and I think that we probably had about 20 of them by now between institutions, various organizations, and agencies across the state. And this ultimately is the first question that we brainstorm with whenever we begin this conversation. Which skills do Oklahoma organizations need most from the current and future talent that they have? Consider, for example, in the news recently, just this week, we've seen that Oklahoma has signed a deal with Panasonic to build a battery plant finally in Pryor at the Mid-America Industrial Park. What kind of skills do you think Panasonic is going to need out of Oklahomans that are going to be working at that battery plant? Alternatively, and what I would like for you all to maybe take a minute and discuss with each other at your table, what skills have you all had to develop amongst yourselves working as an educator? Again, outside of your subject area expertise, what skills have you had to learn as an educator to perfect your craft? So just 30 seconds, everybody share one skill that they've had to pick up that you didn't learn in your graduate program. there's a lot. I would also invite our virtual attendees, if you want to communicate any skills with us, type those in the chat and Anne will pick those up for you. All right, everybody, let's go ahead and pause. So starting with the table over here with Kathy and Ann and Bucky and Wendy, we're going to have everybody share a skill. So one skill, just a word. Let's go.
Oh, budgeting.
Yes. Same. Bucky. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Wendy. Okay. Shauna. Okay. Simon.
Problem solving.
Yep. Kathy. Controlled vocabulary. Kathy, I know what you mean, and I've seen you exercise that skill before. Yes. And I think we have a comment possibly from the virtual audience too. Blackboard, yes, like acronyms. Anybody else at other tables want to share? I promise I'm coming to pick on you all later. Typing, yes.
Teaching and learning, period. Like you may not be a subject matter expert in teaching and learning.
You're lucky if you get one pedagogy course in most graduate programs that aren't teaching, learning, and education. Yeah. Jay. Yes. So again, lots of these things that I'm hearing here, Excel, problem solving, infrastructure, Blackboard, teaching and learning, all of these things, again, we've had to learn along the way. None of us in here have ever had the option of finishing a certification or a degree and being able to say that we're done learning. We all have had a need to upskill. And this is the environment that our college students, as soon as they graduate, encounter the first day on the job. It's what is it that I need to know next? Getting in these conversations with employers, by and large, we hear specific career critical competencies, things that are technical in nature, but we also hear more often than not these other things that are 21st century or softer skills, as we sometimes call them, which at the end of the day are critical workforce competencies. So think about some of those things, again, your own lived experience and the skills that you've had to pick up. I was a graduate level or graduate major of Italian, again. They didn't teach us how to do anything related to online instruction during that program. I also did not even understand the other skills that I had picked up going through such a program. Critical thinking, research, being able to navigate higher education infrastructures and systems, international education, all those kinds of other things. Report writing, do that every single day. Yes. So again, why do we not know how to talk about these things? That's a good question. We're going to see if this YouTube video works here. Maybe, maybe not. Come on, internet. Maybe not. Now it's frozen. So the video ultimately that is on the screen here is an invitation and an advertisement that we actually created initially when UpskillOK was launched to try to invite employers to play in this space with us, to come and have conversations with us about what skills do you need out of your current workforce? What is it that you're finding, not finding? Come on. I know you're connected because we're
upskill your workforce with micro-credential training and college credit courses through upskillok.org, Oklahoma Higher Education's rapid micro-credential training program. If you're looking to provide professional leadership and skills training for your workforce, Oklahoma's public colleges and universities are ready to partner with you to create tailored courses and training programs for job-specific skills. Courses and credentials are aligned with Oklahoma's critical occupations. Upskill your workforce today. Learn more at upskillok.org.
So you can see that we're trying to use a very particular type of language, extending this invitation to employers of saying, develop your talent and advance their skills. At the end of the day, using programs that we may already have or ones that may need to be realigned or created from scratch. That's the invitation that was extended. So I want to set some terms on what we have actually defined at the state system level as being a micro-credential. To clarify what I mean by micro-credential starting out, this is an academic program type. So we're in the level of programs or the land of programs here, swimming alongside of associate's degrees, bachelor's degrees, professional degrees, doctorates, certificates, as well as programs. Micro-credentials ultimately sit at kind of the lowest rung on that program ladder. They ultimately consist of up to 9 hours of credit-bearing coursework. So that can be 1 credit hour courses, 4 credit hour courses, any combination in there of up to 9 hours, or non-credit coursework that includes a form of assessment, with a focus again on readily transferable skills that an individual can take and immediately exercise on the job upon completion or recognition of that credential. You can understand if you worked in higher education for a number of years in program development, how groundbreaking it is to see that and or statement included in there that's in bold red. You now have an opportunity at your institutions of higher education to submit a non-credit learning program that includes a form of assessment to the state regents for endorsement. We are now endorsing continuing education programs on your campus if you are willing to submit them through this program approval process that we'll talk about a little bit later on. Think about all the professional learning opportunities that you have on your campus that are even targeted and designated for an internal audience. Is there an opportunity where you may create a program that could be external facing based upon something that you're already doing that actually meets the need of these Oklahoma employers? You can't tell me, for example, considering we have so many instructional design professionals here today, that a company like Panasonic coming in that's building a battery factory won't have a teaching and learning unit part of their organization there. They absolutely will. How is it that we may be able to provide some certifications even to their employees to help them create these opportunities? But once again, at the end of the day, this is a workforce initiative. It's about helping people understand what it is that they gain by going through a credential program and giving them the language that they need to be able to have a conversation with an employer and document within a job application or on their resume or whatever the next advent, you know, of sharing your credentials and expertise in the form of a resume or whatever this turns into, the direction we're headed. We've got to do a better job, again, at connecting people, giving them this language. And I also think of recognizing and kind of, addressing these programs that we've been doing for so long in continuing education as being something that is valid, that is rigorous, that does have assessment included, and can be valuable for employers, particularly in this environment of skills-based hiring that is not going away anytime soon. Employers like Panasonic don't have the luxury right now of being able to say, we want a degree attached to every single job that we have. We need to provide credentials that, again, help people identify this person can be a battery technician. They've taken 3 courses in an institution that helped them prepare for this job. Doesn't mean that they're going to stop learning or coming back to our institutions, but they can be equipped. They can be viable to apply for a position with employers like Panasonic. So, we like to also discuss building blocks for micro-credentials to try and expand a little bit your vision as far as what is it that I may be able to consider as something that is part of this kind of a program structure. Because again, we have the structure of credit-bearing courses, which can be up to 9 hours, but how is it that we can measure learning in other ways? So we have applications, assessments, badges and certificates from other providers, credentials from other providers, educational experiences that take place outside of the classroom, membership in various organizations, which could either be focused on our own campuses, maybe affiliated with the industry that they're working with. Payments are something that can also be considered. These, by the way, are largely pulling from metadata fields that you can program on a digital badge, which we'll get to here later. Portfolio artifacts. Think, for example, about the colleagues that we have at UCO with a transformative learning record. There are artifacts that learners submit and have documented based upon those competencies. Why would we not want to include those perhaps as a recognized element of a credential? Projects, professional experiences. So we have many learners that are already working in their field. Are there things that they are doing that we could have them provide validation, verification of something having been completed that we could honor within the construct of a program? Volunteering, think about service learning within each of our fields. Giving individuals an opportunity to go and volunteer, that's a measurable learning activity that takes place there. We can recognize that as a building block for a program. The one thing that I will point out is the italicized text there. Participation is never permitted to be the only building block for a micro-credential. Workshops are wonderful. If you want to provide a certificate of completion for a workshop, that's awesome. But at the end of the day, participation or an OSHRI-approved micro-credential has to be combined with one of these other assessed forms of learning, observed behavior. We want to observe that these students can actually perform what it is that we're asking them to. Anybody have any questions at this point? Make sure we're all here. Everybody's so focused. Woo. So what does this mean for talent acquisition? I've already floated the term out there of skills-based hiring, which I think everybody in here has probably heard at some point or another, really indicating again that we don't have the luxury of requiring a degree for every single opening that's out there on the Oklahoma job market. We have to start looking at the skills that people are gaining, making sure that employers also know where those things are happening and being developed in our programs. We need to develop more programs to target Oklahoma's 100 critical occupation areas. We need to provide innovative recognition of resume-worthy achievements, which happens through badging. Tracy's going to talk about that here in a little bit. We need to talk to employers about the skills and outcomes they care about. Oftentimes, especially whenever we've gotten into the room with them, the answers are not exactly what we expect. Sometimes the answers are far simpler than what we expected in the conversation. And it's like, well, of course we can provide you with Excel training for your employees. Yes. Opportunities for lifelong development, professional development, and training for emerging technologies. Becky mentioned a book earlier on long life learning. I hear a lot of comments from people at institutions, concerned comments about what is this doing to the value of our degrees? At the end of the day, my perspective is that we're really building in incremental credentialing for our students so that we're recognizing along the way in their pathway what it is that they're doing, what they can do, the outcomes that they're achieving, and not making them wait until the end to get a summative credential. Some people, that is why they're not coming to our colleges and universities these days, is because 2 years or 4 years minimum is too much time. It's too far in the future for them to really even be able to conceptualize at this moment. So shouldn't we be providing opportunities for them on a more short-term basis? Again, if people are getting these credentials, why would they not recognize down the line? I got a credential from Rose State College. I got a credential from Western. This counts towards a degree and I need a degree now. Where else am I going to go? The place where I took these courses previously that I know is going to count them. So again, how can we be recruiting these students to be those lifelong learners? Integrating credentialing and professional development pathways. This is a huge area that I think we need to improve upon continuously. How do we recognize that when people get on the job for a number of years, they gain competencies, they take industry assessments. Those can be incorporated into our learning outcome structures. They are aligned with many of the things that we teach in our classes, but many times we don't recognize it. That's to the detriment, I think, of many learners. The next video that I'll show you here, if we can get it to load, is the invitation we extended to learners to enroll in these programs or take a look at them. I think mode is just patience here. It will happen eventually. Yeah.
Oklahoma colleges and universities now offer career-specific micro-credential programs to equip you with skills valued by employers. Invest in yourself and increase your earning power through higher education. Visit upskillok.org.
So again, that's the messaging we're trying to give to learners, that we want them to be interested. Invest in yourself. Increase your earning potential with these programs. We're trying to do a lot of the legwork of informing employers about these new kinds of programs out there. And the fact that there is rigor, there is measured learning that's attached to these, they can be just as valuable to you in some cases as a degree within your hiring process. We have a couple of benchmarks for what we consider to be a successful micro-credential program. These are strategies that we try to ask every institution to adhere to, and sometimes they happen on different levels depending upon the program and what the infrastructure is available on each campus out there. The first goal that we really have is to develop sector-specific programs. We want our institutional partners to be out there talking to individual employers, addressing that list of 100 critical occupations, visiting with those people that aren't finding the talent that they need, and figuring out how to either align existing programs or create new ones to be there. We're also integrating our Open Educational Resources Initiative with this, with again, that kind of guise that these learners need these tools for long life learning. They need these tools on the job well after they exit the classroom. Why would we not want to make these tools available to them? And perhaps their colleagues as well. Alignment with local and regional workforce resources. This includes exploring new partnerships with local workforce boards to be able to take advantage of things like incumbent worker training and on-the-job training. There's almost $10,000 available for single employees to take advantage of training programs through federal funds. We're trying to help figure out the pipeline for institutions to take advantage of that. We've also begun exploring partnerships with programs like Oklahoma Job Corps, where there's a requirement in some cases for individuals to earn a secondary short-term credential. We now have a post-secondary short-term credential that can meet those requirements and be completed in as little as a year, if not way less than that. A big part of micro-credentialing is supporting non-traditional adult learners. think about the fact that the 9-hour max out for micro-credentials aligns with the non-degree seeking admission policy for your institution. You may have learners that are able to enroll in these programs that never have to take a placement test. They don't have to provide their college transcripts. There's an easy path for them to get enrolled. This also comes with some risk. These learners will need a particular attention and level of support from us that may be different than what we give to traditional learners, even our traditional online learners. So how are we going to do that? And once again, the fifth one, promoting those clear outcomes to learners and employers. So as you think about micro-credential programs on your campus, you may have some good ideas as far as potential opportunities available, but ask yourself if ultimately you're meeting these five benchmarks through that program opportunity. And again, they don't always have to be at 100%. You may not, for example, be able to use OER right away in all of your micro-credential coursework, but you should know that you're creating a barrier if you're requiring students to pay a cost of learning materials for these courses. How is it that we could resolve that moving forward? Woo. This is the best video. I don't want to get past this one. The video that we're about to show you right here is actually on a partnership that Bucky mentioned earlier during his keynote speech regarding a program at OSU called Drilling Basics Online. You're going to get to hear from not only the program representative and myself regarding this program, but the industry partner that worked with them on its development. I think you'll find his words probably more compelling than mine and Caitlin's, bar none, but let's hear from all three.
Micro-credentials are a very new way of thinking about training future generations of the workforce. So it's kind of not traditional to go to a university just to learn a few skill sets. You earn an entire degree. But with micro-credentials, you can get the little pieces you need to be more successful in your field.
I think that we've opened our doors to an entire new market of individuals who may have never thought that college was right for them, but now they would see, I have an opportunity to complete a short-term learning opportunity, one that I know is connected to what an industry partner needs, because we've done that work of connecting the institutions with those industry partners and employers to create something that matters.
We had industry coming to us and saying, how do we develop training right now to meet this immediate need? And so I had a conversation with Robert Keyes, and he is very heavily involved with the National Groundwater Association. I mean, he is very enthralled in the pulse of the groundwater industry.
And so these certifications will not just give you the basis of drilling of whatever industry you're drilling in. At any juncture along the way, they can then cross over and say, hey, you know what? Maybe I can become a professional. Maybe I can be a geologist or hydrogeologist in this through this whole program.
So when they graduate, they now have a resume full of not just a degree and theoretical foundational knowledge, they have real tangible, practical, applicable skills that they can use first day on the job.
So what's really unique about this program at OSU is that it's non-credit. It's an 8-part micro-credential in drilling basics, so groundwater drilling. You have learners that are invited that are that non-traditional audience. So those people that never would have an intention of enrolling in a bachelor's degree program at OSU that are now being invited and recruited to participate in this kind of online program. You also have the engineering hydrogeology students at OSU who are earning this micro-credential on top of that bachelor's level engineering degree in some cases as a career relevant competency and credential. So again, engineering students don't always have the easiest time entering the job market, but this credential ultimately can provide them with an entry-level salary. For those that don't have an engineering degree of 50 to 60,000, it goes well beyond that for those that do have that 4-year credential for this particular field. So you hear the words too from the industry partner there about, we set up this training quickly. And that really is what we can provide to industry partners is knowledge transfer. We have so much infrastructure and expertise set up. That's what every one of us here does every single day. And they don't. they just don't have that same level of expertise. Many of them don't have the funds available to invest in that kind of support infrastructure for their organization. This is the time. This is the major opportunity that we have in front of us to be able to serve them using things and processes that I promise you will be amazing to them. You'll be so surprised that they don't know what instructional design is. They don't know how virtual and augmented reality can really be used effectively in the classroom experience. So it's your time to shine, ultimately, as educators with these industry partners. Couple of pilot projects before I'm going to turn it over to Tracy to talk about some of our programs and also digital badging. We funded from the state regions this initiative now for 2 years with expected renewal moving forward. We now have over 180 programs available that have been submitted from our institutions through the state regions for authorization from 20 of the 26 or 27, campuses across the state system of higher education. So almost everybody is about on board with this. We've provided matching scholarship funds. That's one of the kind of guiding principles of this program. When we fund an institution, we ask that they work with employers and get them to put some skin in the game. Most oftentimes, they're willing to do that, whether through paying for the scholarship of the program, giving students time off, or any other kind of benefits that you may be able to generate, including preferential advancement opportunities within an organization. We've also had billboards up around OKC and Tulsa, so watch out for those. We'll probably do another cycle, I would imagine, around August. Tracy, I think you're up next. Yep. Yeah. So 180 programs, 20 campuses, 56 industry partners that we have actually identified and are listed on our website. Scarlett's a really good person to talk to about how you can forge some of those partnerships among many other people in here.
Pulling what they actually mean. Mm-hmm. What I did in Environ, it's not Environ, a thermal, was I took their job posting.
Yes.
And I put it into essentially a resume builder and pulled all the skills. And then I took Coursera and said, okay, I want this list of skills. What programs provide them? And we found on the supply chain management program, talked to Rutgers that they could then immediately set up, and six of their seven people are already finished with first two sessions. So, and that took me 3.5 weeks. From, hey, we need help to their enrollment
program. And we'll talk a little bit more about Coursera here in a minute, too.
Yeah, Chris, using JavaScript, since I can use Tonet.
Yes, I love
that. Okay. Lightcast, also, which used to be NC, also has an amazing skills extraction tool that you can copy a lot of things into. Awesome.
Floods into a lot of ATS systems.
Yeah.
Because when we don't oversight for HR, we don't usually plug our own job skills in, and when we get to that end, it's like, yeah, just put a stand in it.
Tracy's going to talk to you about some of the programs that have been approved since December. That is 50, by the way, that we've approved since December 16th. February, I think we had 14 new programs. March, we had 23 new programs. So a lot of them coming in these days.
And I've talked with some of you today, and I've heard you're sending a lot more our way. So I'm very excited about that. So absolutely. So these are just a few programs that we've added since mid-December. So we have a variety of business courses through OCCC. They've just gone to town, grant writing, economics, accounting, et cetera. Northeastern has a great alternative certification for teachers. I know that's been a hot topic in our legislature, all over the state, just talking about keeping our great teachers. So they have a program there. And there are a couple other schools that also have the same thing. We recently got the medical billing and coding micro-credential from OSU OKC, which allows a student to go through this training in the micro-credential and actually be prepared to sit for the exam to become the professional coder or biller, which a lot of people enjoy doing, because a lot of times you can do that from home, and people that have young children that want to work can do that type of job. So it's been really helpful. Rogers State, we have, again, more business courses. They've recently added, and we have seven schools that have signed up for this correctional officer initiative. They've already added some community policing and fundamentals of detention and correction. So they're kind of getting started on that. We're waiting for other things to come in from you guys. But these will all give opportunities for employees at many of these entities that need correctional officers, prisons, and so on, that they can have, you know, employment and be able to advance within that whole system. Rose State, we have personal trainer, biotechniques. They've sent some other ones in here lately, and I haven't gotten a chance to put them on. Seminole State has been great. They pull the majority of their things from Coursera. So they're one of our schools that partner with Coursera, so they can pull in the information like Scarlett was talking about, kind of matching job descriptions with what Coursera courses have to offer to our students.
Can I just speak up and ask Scarlett to talk about the SOC Native Language Workshop for her credential?
So we have a supplemental grant at our NASMTI program, and we were looking for Native Language Workshop, SOC Native Language. The Second Fox Nation said, hey, we'd love to teach a workshop. So it was a 4-week course. They came in once a week, and she taught the basics of the SOC language, both from reading and speaking it. And it was phenomenal. I actually managed to go to 3-4-1 myself. It was phenomenal. And we're in the process of doing both Osage and Potawatomi by the end of summer. So We're trying to get
6 in before December 1st. That's fantastic. All right, we have one from SWASU, and actually we have a couple more that we've added that we haven't put on the website yet, but there's Advanced Marketing Communications. And then of course, USAO has some human resources, and they also have an alternative certification program that students can go through. So we have
three. I feel like it's also focused like OCCC, for example, and RSU. You see accounting, you see business in there, economics. So think about even like the core courses within the major programs that you have on your campus that may be introductory for other programs that you have. What are the skills and competencies happening? You can't tell me somebody going through financial and managerial accounting couldn't come out and actually perform that day as a bookkeeper. Very possible. So again, look at sets of courses together. Laura?
So are they offered online as well?
It's a mixture, actually. We have online course or programs, face-to-face traditional programs, some that are offered in hybrid, many that are offered in any format available. Mm-hmm. And Tracy will show you how that's identified here.
Yeah, there was one that I was going to... Oh, I totally lost it. Sorry. Okay, perfect. All right, so we have 12 schools that have signed on with contracts with Coursera. Some have signed up because they don't have the program experience. They don't have the faculty to teach some of the courses that are offered through Coursera. Some of them just like the ease of having all the materials already furnished. These are 100% online. They have coaching. They have any kind of support that you could need. 5,000 plus courses from Dan Analytics is the hot one now.
No, it is built in to all of the Coursera programs. I know. How people are doing, I know if we've got any longevity, I know if we've got any plagiarism going on, and they send that to me every single week.
Okay.
It is phenomenal for that.
And then you go in on a student level and then kind of maybe reach out and say, are you having trouble? Right. You know, can we help you? Perfect.
McKenna, we were having questions earlier regarding Coursera Plus. There's a subscription-based model out there, $3.99 a year or
yeah, I think
price. This is a difference.
Yes.
You don't have that kind of ability to monitor learners, or learners don't have that ability to get that kind of support that they go through Coursera independently, but we can embed those support infrastructures at our institutions into Coursera programs. And Scarlett, sounds like you're doing a great job of keeping an eye on that. And it's necessary because the risk we run with Coursera type programs, if you just let somebody enroll and expect them to finish, they're probably not going to finish. We need to nudge, check how they're doing, make sure they're progressing.
Any questions about the slide? Okay. If you're interested in learning more about Coursera and a possible partnership, please reach out to us.
Yeah, we will go through a renewal negotiation with Coursera that all state system institutions as well as the private institutions can opt into. We'll begin those conversations in the next month or so with firm commitments due after budgets are released in July.
Okay.
So OU has done a really wonderful job of using Coursera. And I think that what their catalog really demonstrates here is Coursera can help you be nimble as an institution. I also don't want to sound like I'm endorsing Coursera as a vendor by any means. There are so many companies out there that are third-party curriculum providers that can do something similar, Ed2Go, Straighter Line, other kinds of offerings like that. But you can see it's allowed them to set up programs like electric vehicles and mobility. So quickly being able to being prepared and able to serve companies like Canoe, who just closed on the Terex plant out in the Yukon area there, or in Panasonic. So,
Okay. So the approval process is pretty quick. Start to finish, it could be just a matter of weeks, especially the more information that we're furnished with in the beginning. And usually what happens is it comes in our badge email, and I'll take a look. And if I have a question, I'll reach out. I have to kind of summarize all this for the next person that's going through the approval process, basically just kind of lining it out. And then it's just a matter of creating a badge and attaching it to the micro-credential and then getting it on the website. So it's pretty streamlined.
I'll clarify, this is once it gets to us. You all may have processes internal at your institution that have to, you know, be approved, multiple voices being able to have a say, you know, as far as what's happening with the proposal. But once it comes to us, it's a very abbreviated process. For those of you that are also the curriculum nerds in the room, no letter of intent on these programs. So yeah, there's no opportunity for anybody to object about what another institution wants to do with micro-credentials. So it's kind of a good experiment in a way.
Okay. This is supervisory skills micro-credential that was developed by TCC in conjunction with Macy's Fulfillment Center. So Macy's actually reached out to TCC and said, listen, we need a micro-credential for our frontline supervisors. Can you develop something for us? They found something in Coursera. They're actually working on a partnership now together to offer this micro-credential nationwide to any Macy's facility, to any frontline supervisor worker. Students at TCC, business management students, can also take this micro-credential, and once they complete it, have prioritized ability to apply with Macy's, maybe possibly get a supervisor job or one higher than that, manager, et cetera. But this has been a really good partnership. And as I said, Macy's had reached out to Tulsa Community College. So these are the kind of things, these are the kind of connections that we're hoping that you're making with your industry partners in your towns. And I know you have. I mean, I've talked to a number of you and you're working very hard. And sometimes some employers are more cooperative than others. So just keep at it. We really applaud all your hard work.
If we can ever participate in your conversations as well, or be of any assistance, even just being a rear end in a chair, we love attending these interactions. It's been one of the best parts of this project, and part of this role is getting out there and witnessing how some of these conversations go. I sat on a call recently with Scarlett in the Department of Corrections and hearing them talk about, of course, like general psychology. And again, what could we do to possibly make this more relevant for this population? It's exciting work. And again, it's kind of cool, I think, to be able to bring their perspective into courses like that.
Okay. Okay, here's our website. So I welcome you to go visit it at some point in time, kind of look and see. We have different funnels, one for employers, one for employees, students, and one for institutions. The institution page talks about submitting a new micro-credential and some of the paperwork that needs to be filled out, answers some questions. The employer funnel is more about what is a digital badge? You know, what are you looking towards? Maybe reach out to us because you have a need and you want to connect with the university. We have an employer interest form that it's been filled out a couple of times and we referred them to different places. One was for like a respite hospice worker. Another one was asking about professional development in K-12 schools. So we'll try to find the best connection, or we'll reach out to you and say, hey, are you interested? I can send this person your way. So anyway, we have those separate funnels. And then on the any of the funnels, you can see the list of micro-credentials. And they go by the last ones that we've received that have been approved. You can search by program, delivery method, or campus. You can pull up the micro-credential, see the actual badge image itself, the description of the micro-credential, what campus it is, how it's offered, and then the criteria that you need to earn for that micro-credential. So all that information is there And then there should be a link. We've asked each school to kind of develop an internal URL. So if they want to go to your site, they want to go to Rose or Western or whatever, they can click on it and they can go to that site that talks about the micro credentials that you have. Okay, sorry. Talk. Okay, more about digital badging. So here's a digital badge for biotechniques. Talks about the things that we talked about. One thing I do want to stress here, really, when you're sending in those micro credentials, the more skill tags, the better. They take a minimum of 3, and there's suggestions that we can add more. But if you guys have 25, we don't care. Just send them all. Any kind of content that you think is relevant within the course of study within the micro credential, add it to the skill tag, because on the right is a talent directory. So any student that completes that micro credential is going to show up under that skill tag. So if I'm Boeing and I'm looking for a coder or a programmer, or maybe I'm looking for critical thinking skills, I can go and type that in. I can get a list of students that have completed that micro credential that had that particular skill tag. I can even reach out to them and offer them a job or maybe meet with them. At the same time, people within the directory can look at the jobs that they have that are associated with the skill tag and find out, oh, that could be a programmer's job. I could make like $70,000. Oh, by the way, they have a job opening in California. I mean, it gives you that type of detailed information. So it works well for both sides. Be quiet.
Good question.
Yeah.
So this is, the portal is which those who have been marked credentials suddenly find themselves outside of the Oklahoma ecosystem.
Mm-hmm. If they, it can stay private. They don't have to share it. If they've completed a micro credential and they don't want to share their badge, they don't have to. If they want to, they automatically show up here.
And that is optional then?
Yes.
Learners control their data at the end of the day. And they can also filter the job postings that they're looking at by region, state, zip code to narrow down what it is that they're looking for.
Okay. So this is an example of Brad's portfolio of his badges. So he has quite a few. He could take a copy of this to his next job interview if he'd like. He could attach a URL for each badge within his resume to let them look at the badge, and they can then drill down into it and kind of see what the badge was for and how he earned it. He can print a certificate from Credly for each one of these if he'd like. You can just post a picture of the badge. And then, of course, you know, we talked about it being authentically verified. Did you want to?
Ann's got a couple questions.
Sorry, Ann.
In chat.
Absolutely. Yes, I would.
Hyperlinks. It's that simple.
Right.
Each of these badges has a unique URL once it's issued to its earner, and you can hyperlink that on your resume. Many other tools also, such as Smart Resume, are now digesting digital credentials for resume generation. So multiple ways that an individual could use this tool to talk about what it is that they've earned, including traditional, you know, Word document resumes.
Right.
There's some places that just are badge cases.
Yes.
Showcase job for LinkedIn.
Next question, Ariana.
Is there a different cost to students in regular tuition fees, or is it subsidized in some way or financially?
Non-credit micro-credentials are going to always be the cheapest option available to learners, just because we can largely customize those fee structures based upon the cost of instruction. For micro-credentials based upon courses, it's regular tuition and fee structures unless the institution decides to come up with something different. Having said that, there's scholarship funds available from the state regents of up to $1,000 per student for both types of programs. So per calendar year that they can get from us, in addition to the support from the employers. The LSU program, for example, between the state region support, in addition to the support from the National Groundwater Association and an electric company within the state, students going through that pay zero, and they're actually advertising it that way on their website for now. So varies in structure and cost, but ultimately support's available for every student pretty much going through these programs.
Are these nationally recognized?
So Bucky, I'm sure, would have a lot to say about this. He mentioned a website earlier. Bucky, it's escaping me. Going and looking at credential engine. So there are global efforts right now to be able to get a handle on what's happening in this space, because these credentials are multiplying exponentially. It's impossible right now to keep track of the number of these that are being created, which is why in our review process, we place such emphasis on, are the skill tags fully communicating this? Is the description robust? Are those activities that are being communicated actually measurable to make sure that when these go to employers, they know if it's coming from our state system of higher ed, that there's that rigor and competency behind it? Because you can get some of these credentials from private offering parties that are watered down or really don't have that kind of assessment in there. Again, I always think about Excel with this. I mean, we've all put on there that we know how to do Excel, but not everybody that puts Excel on their resume really knows how to do Excel. So, it's kind of that matter. Like, I can do a LinkedIn learning course, but is that going to be as great as another offering that I know has been certified by a higher ed faculty member?
All right. So we're just talking about sharing here on this slide. You can share it on Facebook. You can share it on LinkedIn. You can make a copy of it for your resume. You can copy the link and include that in your resume as well. We've seen it in a number of different places. So that's just an opportunity that you have. And again, it's private. If a student doesn't want to have their information shown publicly, they can say, no, I don't want to share. They can also add their, we suggest that the students add their college address, their email address, and also their personal. So when they graduate, when they leave, that's with them forever. Put in their Gmail account or whatever. You guys have it. If you guys switch jobs or whatever, then you've got it in your personal resources. Okay. So this is what I talked about earlier about the employer interest form. So if you have anyone that you're talking to or having coffee, or whatever, and someone says, you know, I want to meet with someone to determine if they can write a program for public speaking, then just send them to the website. They can fill it out. We'll get it. We'll reach out to them, kind of find out what their needs are, what they, you know, who they might like to connect with, and just go from there. That's kind of how the process starts.
Yeah.
Yay. And
okay. So I know we have like 2 minutes here, but I want to know the ideas that may be rolling around your head right now regarding, you know, number one, like, what's your perspective just in general about micro-credentials, this upskilling initiative? But number two, do you have any ideas from where you sit in your position on your campus about a potential program opportunity? The last thing that I'll put out there is Tracy and I have a travel budget and would love to come to your campus and visit with you about micro-credentials.
That's right. So
if this was not enough of this topic today, you have our email. It's actually badges@osrhe.edu. That goes to all the people working on this. We've visited numerous people. We've been out to Seminole a couple of times. Like, I would love to come talk to you all about how we can build these programs on your campus. But any ideas, Robert, would you like to share?
No, just one purpose plug at what we're doing at UCO, at least for the IPXP side, is that we did build our own badge system just for fun. It's really weird. We can display any badge that we want from wherever we want. It can get pretty crazy. But the big thing that we're actually coming from that is going to be skill trees. So what we're doing from there is we take a look at some of the gamification efforts and we actually start cataloging the skills that people are learning in those courses, map them out to how those skills would associate to other courses within our catalog, and then allow students to see their learning journey through that.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things that we'll work on.
Right.
This kind of pathways notion, I know Badger and Instructure recently, I think, have kind of gotten a little bit further ahead of the game compared to the other vendors, but I've heard when from Credly that they're also working on this kind of branching tree connection structure with credentials, because it's hard right now for people to visually associate one badge with another if it's connected, much less how that connects to other things they're doing.
Or even out of your skills that you said that you are taking this math course, when we sat down and we got our instructors catalog with our time maybe learning that, you can at least provide another way to show the legal value of that math.
Couldn't agree more.
And our repository that's online is free. So it's free advertising for you guys. So
yeah, the State Regents provides badges through Credly to each institution at no cost. If you all want to get your own badging platform to do your own thing, you absolutely have leeway to do that, but just know that cost is not meant to be a barrier for institutions regarding friendly digital badges overall.
One thing that I've also used when I'm talking with individuals about like skill trees and things, PhiladelphiaFed.org has a program called the Occupational Mobility Explorer, and it uses skill-based approach to occupational mobility. So you put in what you're currently doing, and then you put in a general idea of what you may want to do, and it shows you how to get there. So by using that, you can pull up, like, okay, I'm a CSR at Walmart, and I want to go into networking. what skills do I have now? How do I get? PhiladelphiaBed.org. It's called the Occupational Mobility Explorer.
One more comment, question, or idea, Laura.
I was just thinking about way back when I did this medical billing and coding certificate at the Community College of California. And I was thinking about the assessment. So we had to have a rigorous assessment. So I'll tell you one thing, after I received that certificate, I went and got a job working at Intel, so because I had that certificate.
Yeah.
I was really proud. So also, I don't know, just from having taught online classes, I guess I'm a little wary about the Coursera and as far as the assessment. You know what I mean?
Have you taken a Coursera course yet, Laura? If you're interested, if anybody here is interested in trying one out, I have 500 scholarships for the Google Grow with Google programs. If you want one, email badges at OSRHE and I'll get you set up and you can start right away.
Yeah, we have a number of them as well.
Yeah,
we'd be happy to help.
It's more, I will say, rigorous than I was expecting out of Coursera. I started their project management certification through Google just to see, went through, I think, the first two units.
And
it's intense.
And be fair, it's grown since
yeah.
A library science copyright.
Yes.
And that one's.
Yeah, maybe we should get ahead of the game and create a copyright and AI and micro credential. Everybody, thank you so much for being here and taking time to learn about micro credentials. And thank you to our virtual attendees. Have a great afternoon.